I've ever seen. In fact, I was quite envious of where he's been and what he's done. He's been not only an adventurer, but he's been expedition leader. He's, as a cameraman, he's been a lead cameraman throughout the world. He's been involved in base jumping, in canoeing down rapids, climbing mountains, including the Himalayas. He's been associated with some very famous people, including Hillary. And also he's been associated with some quite reputable organisations such as the National Geographic in terms of filming. He's won international awards and recently he received the Queen's Birthday Award, which is the Order of Australia. He's a member of the Order of Australia as from June this year. So ladies and gentlemen, I know you've all come to listen to Michael. He's not only an award-winning guy, but he's also a member of our club. So ladies and gentlemen, I'd like you to welcome Mike Dillon.
Thanks very much, Eddie. I've been in the industry a long time, and in theory I could be considered a failure because I haven't become a feature cinematographer and made my fortune. But I don't like doing that. I really like filming, like you probably, things, the real life, things as they happen, and I find that a fair bit of a challenge. And I just want to show you a bit of a scenario that when we're confronted with a real life situation, and this one I'm about to show is an amazing one where it was in Papua New Guinea. Every year all the tribes come down for a sing sing, and there you are with a camera and all these possibilities around you. And I just want to show a bit of a little clip. That's what I'll be doing. I'll be showing various 2 minutes of clips and talking between them. I was filming at that time a musicologist who also wanted to make the most of this. He had his microphones and he was just overawed by this amazing lots of possibilities, and his sentiments expressed on this clip, I guess, are mine or any of us in that sort of situation. So, first one. First thing is that you have to be ready. We have everything to hand, which really means that, of course, you've got your camera in one hand, but there are often things you right need immediately, because the longer it takes you to find them, the more things you're missing. So I tend to talk, have about two of these bum bags, and one might be mostly empty because it's had the camera in it, and the camera can go back in it if it starts to rain or something. The camera itself, I always virtually all the time have a wide-angle adapter on. It just seems to me that if you do not have a wide-angle adapter and you go to the widest point of a normal lens, it still almost looks like, feels as though you're still looking through a keyhole. You're not really seeing the world the way we humans see it. We look at things with wide-angle lenses, and I just feel that it's a wide-angle adapter is virtually much more useful than not having it. And so it virtually sits on top of the camera all the time, and also has a lens hood, because the best video in Australia, particularly with very bright light, the best video shots are really shooting into the sun because of the contrast, lesser contrast. And so you virtually need a lens hood all the time, because often the sun's up here somewhere and you've got to stop getting on the lens. So that's my typical setup. It's often, of course, when you shoot with a wide angle adapter on too, it's much easier to hand hold, and you don't, I've never used one of those Steadicam devices because I find, not that I practice a lot, just about anybody with a wide angle adapter can hold the camera, even walking back, pretty well, so you don't really need one of those Steadicam things, which is just another thing to have to carry around and worry about. So that's the camera. And then normally there'd be a radio mic on top as well. These little Sony radio mics are fantastic. They now run on 2 AA batteries, and it would often sit on top of the camera like that. But when you're not using it, I take it off because sun can sort of cast a shadow on the subject if you have too much all up here. So, but these radio mics are great. Headphones. So that's the main, that might be the main one. But there are a lot of other things that are, again, there's no point in having it in a rucksack because our hands aren't long enough to sort of get round and try to find a lot. You've got to virtually have everything here. This is when you're in one of those situations where you've got to film it and film it quickly. Tissue, lens tissue, spare battery. These batteries are amazing. They last about 500 minutes, these high-capacity ones. But it'll always run out at the wrong time, so you have a spare battery. Tapes, all the tapes, and if you're using a lot, you've got to take the plastic off first. It's so hard to take that plastic off. So take it off first, and if you're going to use about, you know you're going to use about 10, I just put number each one so that you can put the tape straight. There's no time often to write anything. You've just got to get straight onto the next tape and put the next tape in. Remote control. I've actually, to be honest, I've never used it, but you might have seen recently on ABC a guy who walked right across Australia with a dog. It was on a few months ago. He used this very well. He, put the camera on a tripod, walked back and set it off, and he'd walk towards the camera. But he made a mistake. He did he's just done another wonderful journey and got 3 weeks into it filming amazing material. And then the camera said, the heads are dirty, clean me. And he didn't have a tape cleaner, cleaning tape with him, and he was in the middle of nowhere. So, and even on a normal day, if you got one in the car and you're some distance away, it's no good. You want to use it immediately. So that's why I just carry all these things right here. This is a good lens hood because telephoto shots are important too. So occasionally you take the wide angle adapter off, and this Sony one is a good one. It's got a good lens hood, whereas the lens hood for the Sony wide angle adapter doesn't exist. I don't even have a thread, so I don't know what Sony have done. This is a different brand which has a thread so you can put a lens hood on it. So, and the good thing about this one is you can put it on, and if it starts to rain, you can. The other thing in here is this one of these amazing Ziploc bags. You can actually put the camera in such a way that the lens just sticks out of the bag, and you can lock this bit and lock that bit, and you can film in rain or snow or whatever, and protected by this very long lens hood. I've just done that. It works really well. So that's basically, well, the first thing is to have to hand everything you really need. And also sometimes, I mean, the trouble is only so much you can carry around your waist, but I suppose the next important one to have if in a slightly more controlled situation is a reflector. You know, one of these things you're probably aware of, but it's the trouble is it's good to film backlit because then you often don't need one of these, but it's often good to get an eye light into somebody. I just want to show the next clip where I've used it in a slightly more controlled situation, except nothing is totally controlled because I was filming two musicians and I had no idea somebody was going to start dancing as they were performing. So here's the next one. Como quieres que te beses de amor, si
para ti. Esperemos un momento mejor, que quiero besarte así. 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 One, one. Así. One, one. Así. One, one. Así. One, one. Así.
Yeah, that eye light, that ability to get an eye light into somebody's faces can be good. It's just, you know, like an artist always does a portrait and the last thing he does is put that little white dot in the centre of the eye and everything comes to life. But again, you can't do it all the time unless you have a lot of assistance. But and the same thing about tripods. Well, that's, I haven't talked about tripods. Mine just fell out there. They're a real nuisance because you really can't carry a tripod around with you and also do all this good handheld stuff. So you try when you need to do a telephoto to try, if you can, to get away without it by... And the trouble with us is we are one leg short of being a tripod ourselves. We've only got two legs and they have three. So often you can try and brace yourself against something or a tree, or I often just go to the ground and put the camera on a... Well, you know, the other thing people have... You can buy commercially these sort of similar bags where you put it on. It's on the ground and you've got it's fairly steady. But the trouble is, you try and do without them and if you can, because of the time factor too. They just take so long to get a shot, camera on the tripod and carrying it around. If you get somebody to help you carry it, they often get in the shot because they're not quite sure where you're shooting. So if you really need one, it's often good to carry a little one around with you, and you can... If you have a little bit more time, just use this. Of course, I've had to use the big ones too, but often you can't get away with it, especially if the subject's moving. It all depends what the style of the editing is. But the next clip, I think I got away with it just for the... Because I was on a boat filming another boat. I couldn't use a tripod.
These boats had a purpose once. They were warships, cannon-firing warships. Rowers, 10 tons of teak, bearing down upon their enemy, cannons ablaze.
So for coverage, then, I sort of feel that generally a wide-angle lens is the sort of thing that the human eye likes to see. They like to be there, and I think anybody starting off, the best advice is just stick on that wide-angle adapter. Never take it off wide-angle, and do what a human does. They look at something, they don't move too much. Everything happens within the frame. If you want to get in closer, you physically walk in closer, as a human does, with their wide-angle eyes, you know, and get in as close as you can. The telephoto side of things, it's always good to mix them up, because I think the appeal of telephotos is it's really a novelty for us. Human eye can't do that. And I think that people like to see telephoto shots. You're getting an angle which in real life you can't get with your own eyes. So a good mix of those two. And also the other thing is the next clip I'm going to show, we had to film a policeman in the Philippines who's famous for dancing as well as conducting traffic. So then you've got to think about, okay, other things, the variety of angles, and you've got to think in 360 degrees. With the subject in the middle, you've got to think of shooting up, shooting down, and just so that you get the variety for the editor. And so we had a bit of forethought on this one because we knew he was in the middle of the road, so we hired a cherry picker so we could, knowing that looking down shots might be a good part of the mix, we could include that too. So this is a sequence where we try and cover things as interestingly as we possibly can. Yeah, the next two clips, I'll talk about the next one that follows, that comes after it. It's another example of trying to get the best coverage possible by thinking of telephoto wide shots and all the different angles you can possibly get. And the one that follows this, when we get this one going, is I had an extra challenge because I had to film it with a broken collarbone. Because I was filming a in another part of Indonesia, a funeral. And part of our greatest danger is when we have to walk backwards, filming some people walking forwards. And I've almost fallen off the Great Wall of China and had a lot of near misses. And this is the first time I'd actually done myself an injury because I was filming this coffin coming to be put in the tomb. And came in the door of the tomb, and the next minute I remember was 5 minutes later I woke up because I'd fallen down into a lower tomb, and so the dead body was lying up here and I was lying dead in the lower tomb, at least they thought I was. So then I had a very sort of bruised shoulder, and both the local witch doctor and the local doctor both said it wasn't broken, so I had to go on filming for a week. And so so the clip which will follow immediately, this one, was another example of trying to get the best angles and so on, and get the best for the editor. Thanks.
There is a story in the Philippines on the streets of San Fernando of a cop who's got loads of cool and never misses his beat. Miguel Balboa strides the crossroads and controls the traffic beasts.
Yeah, it's good editing, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, we've got to give them the ingredients that editors like us to do, get the ingredients right.
Have always been a feature of life on our island of Bali. They were the inspiration for the creation of a dance called Kechak, in which monkeys form the chorus. The dance is based on the Hindu legend, the Ramayana. We improvise the sounds and actions of the monkeys in the course of telling this tale. Thank you.
monkeys often appear in Balinese fables, where they are usually portrayed as mischievous and smart. We believe that monkeys have souls and are reincarnated. One of the principal characters in the ketchup is Hanuman, the monkey general.
So it's all about coverage, really, and often you're working by yourself. The next clip I was working with another crew, we were filming, this is when the Survivor American show came to Australia to do one, and we were often on about a five-hour shifts filming the tribe, and the rules are very strict for us. We weren't allowed to talk to them, they weren't allowed to talk to us. We almost had to be non-beings because so there was no social interaction, or we weren't part of the dynamics of their. So we were just, in a sense, cameras on legs, and we were not allowed to ask them to do anything again. You might get away with saying, "What was that?" If you hadn't got a good angle and they'd said something, you know, it's a good trick to say, as though you hadn't heard it, so you get them to do it again. But we virtually weren't allowed to talk to them, or they us. But the good thing was we were often two crews filming the same thing, or often you were by yourself because a lot of things were happening. There'd be a tribe of eight people. And so we were there for, our task was to try and get things as it happens. I cover it with lots of good angles. One of us might do close-ups, one of us might do, in any one given situation, by signalling each other. One might do the close-ups, one might do the wide shot, which is all part of the editor's ammunition for a good sequence. And we're also told to watch out for those little glances, those things editors like to show that one person doesn't like another person or something. You had to be very observant of capturing those things. So that's just this little bit of our filming, one of the tribes, which is a good tribe because some of them came on to be quite, the winner was in it, and then the girl who won the Survivor All-Stars was in it. So I had it was a good experience also filming with other crews, which you hardly ever get to do.
I mean, we have done fantastic on a small amount of food. You get food in us, we're going to be unstoppable.
Winning this competition means a lot more to us than just bringing home a bag of fishing supplies. These are the days when it comes down to morale and the mental edge going into this. And we're 3-1 now. The stats are pretty good for us. But I certainly don't think this answers everything. We still got to trust the fish. The fish aren't going to jump into our camp.
I didn't think that reward challenge was very important because somebody told me there really wasn't a lot of fish out here, and it sucks that they didn't give us the fish, to give us the means to catch the fish.
Keith said there were no fish. He said, there's no fish out there. Him and Kel both were saying that for days and days.
Holy
They were practically jumping in the boat.
Yeah. Chef T, what are you proud about?
Here we go now. Maybe the fish got it in scale. When they came back with fish, they immediately said, oh, where's the chef? The chef word's never been used before. As a chef, my strategy was to come in here and to create just spectacular dinners and meals. And until now, We've had zero luck at doing anything from the rivers or from the flora for that matter.
Today is day 7 and we've caught our first fish. So actually that's not too bad. Did take us a week, but hey, it's better than 2 weeks.
How do I know that once the fish is caught, I'd be the guy in the ladies?
You did not know at all.
Just look at the dull life he's doing exceptionally well.
Yeah, right.
I think right now everybody's pretty happy that Keith is there to cook the fish that we've been catching. I know sometimes he says things to other people that kind of rub them the wrong way, but I'm probably the one who gets irritated with him the most. I'm aware of that.
Wow. Well, you bread those with that flour and crush it with salt, and put the salt in and bread it with the flour and...
He's done
well, but
it's okay. We don't waste the flour.
The most tension in the tribe seems to be between Jerry and Keith, with the cooking and everyone responding well to her cooking. That put them on a level playing field there, and so there's not really a power struggle yet, but it could definitely come to that point.
He's run from whenever you like a bunch of greedy sharks.
Yeah, I'm doing a cooking class.
Even when Keith was over filleting the fish, I noticed there were several eyes paying attention. And what that tells me is that his stock didn't go up at all. You know, all he did was basically play the role of instructor on how to cook fish.
The fish that Keith made was excellent. That was like a blessing because we were starving. We were so hungry.
So his first meal wasn't that great, but his first meal of fish was fantastic.
Oh my God! It is so good!
Tonight's dinner was definitely a success.
Oh my God.
Since cooking the fish, I think my stock's gone up a good amount. I think the team has been pretty excited about what I've been able to do for them.
It is going good. I've never had such a great meal. But you know what? Jerry could do that. I could even do that. So having a chef out here isn't as crucial as he may think because we don't have a lot to work with.
The next little bit I'm going to show is sometimes I've had to you get an idea. I mainly worked filming other people's, but occasionally you get your own idea. And it's a bit of a head start when you can you don't have to employ anybody to film it because at least I can film. So this was an idea I had that somebody should try and climb Everest the entire height of it from sea level. And so that I ended up sort of filming the journey and then the stage of the hard bit, which is editing it and so on, working with an editor. And so I'm just going to show you the first 4 minutes of the film because like... The first four minutes is the most important because if it's on TV, people are deciding whether they want to change channels or not watch anything at all. So you often do what journalists also do. The first paragraph or the first few minutes of a documentary is often something which is very arresting and grabs people's attention, and then it goes back to start the story a minute or two after that. So I guess that's a technique we used in this one too.
It is very lethargic up here. It's really very difficult to do anything. All you want to do is lie down. That's hard work. You really need to motivate yourself. You've got to have severe discipline in order to even just get by up here.
He speaks from the death zone, high on Everest. He is alone, filming himself, a camera between his upraised knees.
This evening around 9 p.m, I'm going to try and set off for the summit.
The summit is still some 3,000 feet above him. The sea, where his climb began, some 26,000 feet below. He is near the end of a long, long road. On Earth's flattest continent, he trains for towering mountains. In sweltering heat, he steels himself for snow.
this unlikely place, this gold mining region of Australia's west, comes this unlikely giant of the mountain world. Tim McCartney Snape, world-class mountaineer. Already he's climbed the hard route on Everest. Now he plans to return.
Ever since I was a boy, I've loved being in nature, climbing hills. So that first climb of Everest was a glorious experience. But I couldn't help feeling that there was something more to do. After all, Everest's height is measured from sea level. So to really climb Everest, I'd have to climb from sea level.
Ahead of you now, that ultimate climb, that ultimate journey. Across great lands, great rivers, through every layer of our world. His quest to be the first to fully climb Mount Everest. Bay of Bengal, a sacred place where the river Ganges, fed by the snows of Everest, merges with the ocean.
Well, this is the real foot of Everest. It seems like the logical place to start. The last time I reached the summit, I was driven to 16,000 feet.
Further on, it's a 50-minute film, and we walked through India, and we had to remind the audience what he was doing. So this next little sequence is partly for that reason, and it's also a value of a close-up, because he's reflecting, and you really need to get in close. And the other thing about this thing I'm going to show you, there'll be a few shots which are not good shots. I mean, it's hard to know what a good shot is, because often if you turn a camera on, if I threw this camera up in the air and caught it, it's possible that what that shot I took during when the camera's on could be useful in some sequences, circumstances. So, and hopefully this will work. What you could objectively call a bad shot might work subjectively as a good shot. And I hope it does in this sequence, part of it.
The nearer we get, the more I'm starting to worry about what could happen to Tim if things went wrong. I just have to try and control my imagination.
I wouldn't be doing this climb if I hadn't agreed. Climbing to me is so vital. I know it's hard up there. Desperately hard. To me, that's life, not death. It's full-blooded living. Climbing is a life wish, not a death wish.
Just 100 miles to go, and the gateway to Everest, the kingdom of Nepal, is now just moments away.
Sorry I keep interrupting all these films, but I just don't. They were bad shots, weren't they, all that border stuff? I wasn't allowed to actually look through the viewfinder. But it probably works, because after all, that's just a he wasn't allowed through, and that's sort of the sort of trying to create the right impression of chaos, and that it's probably better if I did shoot it that way. It doesn't also matter that often if your lens is dirty or got water all over it, it can be effective. The next little clip is an example of that.
We're in Russia. It's this extreme white water up here.
Well, you can see here the younger generation ready to take risks. Building new boats so they can take on harder and harder rivers. You see, the people are willing to go out and take those risks.
For me, rapid and flood are the same. When they're going to be rapid, the feeling of excitement, the feeling of risk, the danger of leaving the boat, I think that those moments develop all human qualities.
I'm just about got 5 minutes left, so those shots of water, I mean, no one really cared if they have water on the lens because they're dramatic, and certainly we didn't want to be in the boats at the time, so we the length of a shot too, there's no real ideal length of a shot. The next clip, sometimes you're in a situation where something amazing happens and it just keeps getting better, the shot, that's the important thing. Shots have always got to keep getting better as they go on, ideally. And so I think there's one shot in this next clip that goes on for about a minute, because there's always something happening I just didn't want to turn off.
We're in the Sudan, Africa.
So today, perhaps it's not surprising that the Sudanese, like the black pharaohs before them, would wish to control their own destiny, just as the Islamic Messiah, the Mahdi, had tried to do over a century ago. Every Friday at sundown, the descendants of the Dervish army come together. This was how they prepared for battle. Today, it's how they make contact with God. And as the word dervish means poor man, that's how they turn out, some even wearing clothes made from rags. For them, this is a transport of the soul, taking them beyond their ordinary lives and giving them a glimpse of the life in the hereafter. Fall into a trance from the ecstasy of the dance. I wonder if they're drawing on an earlier tradition. One day, they believe, another Messiah, another Mahdi, will be sent by God. So why such an obsession with their self-determination? Maybe they look back to a time long ago, when under the mysterious black pharaohs, the Sudan briefly ruled an empire, which became the envy of the known world. Or maybe, after thousands of years of turmoil, they're sick of being pushed around. Thank you.
finally, time of day, the quality of light, because we people who aren't working with great big studios and huge amounts of lights just have to rely on one, and that's the sun. And the sun is at its best in the morning and at night, and it's at sunset and sunrise. And so you really have to try and get up early. And amazingly, I've been on quite a few shoots where the producer has forgot to set his alarm or take an alarm clock, and if he works up late, look, we get frustrated because we want to be out there in the good light. And here's an example of good light where things went really right and we just got everything. It was just a filming of Fiji and wedding a groom coming up a river to meet his bride. And it was just, you had to pay $1 million to sort of set it up in a studio. We had it, but we had to get up early to get it. I don't know what you learned from that, but I just sort of went going through everything I shot. I was trying to work out what I thought was a good shot. So it's all very subjective, isn't it? I was used to the days when all the bigger cameras, you always have it on manual exposure. In other words, you don't rely on looking through the viewfinder and just letting it decide its exposure. You tend to set it on manual, which is a fairly easy thing to do, and that means it never changes during the course of a shot when bits of light and darkness sort of come across. So we're just the old habit of judging it all by eye through the viewfinder. Sorry?
Chris? When you did the monkey sequence,
yeah.
How did you do the sound there?
The what? The
sound.
We would have had we had a sound recorder start. That was shot on film, and we had a separate sound recorder. So when the producers start to hear about these new Sony high-definition mini cameras that are coming out in about 3 months' time, they're going to say, oh, I'd like it to be shot on that, so we'll have to buy one. And this happens to me all the time. It's just these things are happening so fast that I know that in about 4 months' time I've got to spend at least $9,000 on... there's another camera coming out in 4 months' time, which is Sony high-def mini one, which is 100,080 lines. Yeah. And it looks not much bigger than this. And obviously it's a better picture. And, you know, you can live with these. There's nothing wrong with it. Let's just stop now and be happy with this. but the people, Sony always wants to sell something better. And you know that the first version of that camera is not going to be perfect because I want to sell another version about 2 years and get me broke again with a slightly better version of the camera. It just goes on and on. The good thing, though, these cameras, any camera you've got is just about, don't worry too much about it. If it's one chip, we, on Survivor, all that nighttime stuff we had, we shot, you know, the night vision stuff. If it was a one chip camera, no one cared. A $900 camera. So all this digital stuff's getting so good that don't worry too much about what kind of camera you've got. Just enjoy using it.
Well, Michael, I know when I first spoke to you, I was lucky to catch you between adventures, and I'm very pleased that that you obviously adjust to mountain icy weather and Sydney's heat very quickly. And it's been a real pleasure for you to come here tonight. And I know some very eager people here have been welcoming your talk and also showing things that you can use what we now adopt as our standard camera. And we can also compete with the National Geographic people. Isn't that good? Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like you to give them a big hand for a job.
Yeah, I'll be here till the end, so...